play a very significant role in these exams. That was the sole reason I was not able to get into DOJAT. One single subject does not mean you are completely out of the race. In 2020, I managed to clear DOJAT with such a rank that
you took a full drop. So you placed all your bets on the entrance examinations of 2020. You did not keep IIM Rohtak as a backup. But do you advise people to actually take a full drop, or should it be a partial drop wherein they're at least enrolled somewhere and they are at least giving the exams over there while still focusing on their IPM preparation?
So, Saksham, when it comes to exams, when it comes to taking drop year for an exams, I can't say that it was worth it for me because I did get into college. But if you don't get, it's going to be a very rough time for you, especially when it comes to your mental health. Because the drop year, especially since it was during the lockdown, the exams kept getting postponing again and again. There was complete uncertainty. The same thing I was escaping from in IIM Rohtak, I found it for the next 4 months of lockdown. Taking a drop year, while it's only recommended if you are 100% confident in your abilities. I had attempted flat earlier, hence I knew that if I give it enough time, I will be able to crack it. And that is the only reason I dropped out. Had I had 1% doubt in my mind that I wouldn't be able to crack it, I would not have dropped out. And the confidence in my abilities is what helped me get through this period of drop year, because it is a very taxing time, right? You see your batchmates from school, or in my cases from my college, who are going ahead with their lives, who have their own, who are enjoying their college life, achieving something professionally, and you see yourself sitting at home preparing for an entrance exam, which you probably could have also, like, this factor in your mind ki agar pichle saal thoda pad leta to tab ho jata, I would not have spent an extra year on this. So it's very mentally taxing. So the only way you can cope with that is if you have 100% belief in your abilities, and at the very least you have attempted the exam, if you have not attempted the exam, at the very least you have attempted a mock of that exam and you have gotten a decent score in that, like somewhere, like not good enough to get into that institute maybe, but still like missing it by a few little margin, a margin you feel that you can improve upon. So that's only in those situations is a drop advisable. But take this decision very seriously and stand by it, because after dropping out, if you regret your decision, that's going to be very tough for you to deal with.
Certainly, point taken. And as you mentioned, you had full confidence in yourself that you will be at least be able to do certain things, or some of the other thing, but you still would have had some backups in your mind. So what were the backup options that you kept for yourself?
So while at the time of dropping out, I had full confidence in my abilities, by the time the duration of exams came, it was almost 10 months since I dropped out. And during that people, I had during that period, I lost a lot of confidence. So at that point, I did have a lot of backups. I had Jindal, the LSAT exam is for Jindal. And I did take admission in Symbiosis Law School. So it's like, and after CLAT went, like if you look at what happened in the CLAT of 2020, it was a very weird exam. So I was not sure if I was going to make the cut or not. At that point, I had completely accepted that, okay, now I am a student of Symbiosis Law School. Like I had accepted it with complete grace. So in terms of backup, yeah, I had private colleges, etc. as a backup. There's always the option of going to DU, since I had a decent percentage in both exams, which is why attempting the both fail is very important. So it gives you a backup. But yeah, the confidence part, it does get eroded down over the course of time. So you need to have backups.
As you mentioned, you lost your confidence after you dropped out. So during that time, how was your prep experience like?
So for many months, I did not really prepare for the exams. I was completely depleted and the exams were getting so delayed. I had lost the motivation to even prepare for the exams. So I believe from lockdown till around August, I did not study much for the exams. It was only in August when it was finalized, okay, that will happen, not because they cannot delay it further or they'll have to skip the entire year. So at that point, I began studying. But during that three, four month period, I did not really study. Now, in that last moment, when I knew I had to somehow like crack this exam because this is my last opportunity, I enrolled in that LSAT course, Khan Academy course, as I said. I took two different coachings just to, even though I did not need those coachings, I knew I like every material in that coaching you can access somewhere or the other. And I did not need teachers because I had already had the experience of having cracked these exams. So I knew what to expect from them. Despite that, out of desperation, I'm not sure how many different coachings and different resources I accessed at that point. But my main saving grace was YouTube. I mean, YouTube is amazing when it comes to stuff like this. If you are confident, like if you're finding skills are good enough, you can find all the content that you need on YouTube. For instance, I found a lot of GK marathon videos on YouTube. My last week, that's how I spent before CLAT, like 28th September, between 20 and 28th September, that's how I spent watching marathon GK videos. So I think that's it with respect to that.
All right, perfect. So as you mentioned, you know, YouTube certainly is a great source and you can find everything over there. So having like been someone who's running an entrance preparation course myself, I would say, of course, even when people come to me and talk over counseling sessions, I say the same thing. You can find everything on YouTube. The only reason why you want to join an entrance preparation course is to have a clear focus, someone who can mentor you with things, and also an organized way of studying. Because of course, you know, everything is available there, but you need to make your decisions, which one's better, which one's not. And the content is available in enormous quantities. So in that case, making that decision, people end up wasting a lot of time just in the process of deciding what resource to opt for. But you know, if you're getting something and you're finding it good, just trust the process, go ahead with it. If you think like it's helping you increase the marks in box, well and good. But if not, and if you feel like, you know, having a mentor is essential for you, and having that organized way of studying is also, you know, going to expedite the process of getting through these exams, that is when, you know, maybe you should look forward to an entrance preparation course. With that being said, so how was your CLAT specific? Okay, so we have talked about, you know, IPM or like the preparation in general. So you did CLAT specific, like your preparation was geared more towards CLAT or law entrances in your second year of appearing for these entrances. What do you think are the differences between preparing for IPMAT and preparing for CLAT?
IPMAT is a very technical exam because it has a very high segment of QA. Even the LR of that exam is slightly technical. It's more numerical, like number based than anything else. In CLAT, it's more reasoning based. Every single question of yours, it has a certain reasoning involved in it. Even the verbal questions, English questions, even cons, everything has a certain element of reasoning in it. So that's a very important difference, which is why you really need to brush up on your reasoning skills, because unless you're able to argue that why are you arriving at the conclusion you are, you won't be able to crack these exams. Because when it comes to legal reasoning for CLAT, the answers are so similar, you won't probably be able to tell the difference between the answers, least of all identifying which is the right one. So you need to have understanding of why a sentence is structured the way it is. What is the subtle difference between the two answers? And why is one of those two answers the right one? So with respect to CLAT, you have to be very, like, your approach, because in IPMAT, you need to understand the method of solving that question. In CLAT, you need to understand the reasoning behind that question, that what was in the mind of the examiner when they were asking this question. Because when it comes to legal reasoning, many of the questions are simply based upon common sense. You don't even need to understand the law to answer those questions. I did not focus too much upon studying legal questions, like understanding, okay, this is what happens when a contract is not fulfilled. I did not waste my time with that. Instead, I focused on what would be the commonsensical answer to this question. And that helps out a lot, especially if you're not sure about an exam. Think as if you were the judge in that scenario, what would you decide simply based upon common sense? And that should be your answer.
Perfect, point taken. So, you know, we talked about the attempt strategy you had in your DUJAT and IPMAT. What was your attempt strategy like for these law entrances?
So when it comes to ALIT, you have to be fast. You have to be extremely fast, because there's no way you'll be able to complete the exam. I don't think I know anyone who managed to complete the ALIT exam, which is not a big deal, because remember this, the exam is of 150 marks and the cutoff is 75 marks, only half of it. So you don't need to rush through, like you don't have to focus upon completing it. You just have to focus upon what is your core strength. My strength was reasoning, which is why I took up LR first. Then I took up GK, because well, GK can be finished off in a few minutes. You don't have to spend time on that. You know the answer or you don't. So you don't have to come back to it and think about it. You know the answer or don't. And even if you don't know, attempt it, because statistically speaking, you have a higher chance of getting the answer right than getting it wrong. And despite negative marking, if you look at it like plus one, minus 2.5 basis, you still end up gaining a little, like statistically, you'll end up gaining marks even if you don't know the answer. As long as able to eliminate one or two of the options that this cannot be the right answer, go ahead, attempt it. Talking about CLAT, CLAT had an entirely new pattern this year. Like, it was completely unprecedented. The previous pattern was very different from this pattern, and even the mocks that the CLAT consortium has released, those were also very different from the actual exam, especially when it comes to the GK part. Because earlier, GK used to be asked facts. Now you were asked opinion-based questions. For instance, there was a question about a deal in the Middle East between Israel and, I believe, Saudi Arabia. One of the questions was, why did Donald Trump sponsor this deal? Like, why did he promote this deal? Now, that is not a factual question. You need to understand the crux of the matter. You need to understand what happened in that in order to answer that. And this was not a standalone question. This was based upon a paragraph which had five similar questions. So you really need to understand everything that there is about a certain topic if you want to clear the GK in CLAT. ALET still has a typical pattern of factual questions where they'll ask you, okay, who was awarded this particular award, or like questions like that. But for CLAT, you need to primarily, I'd suggest, read the editorial section of the newspapers. Not because many people suggest reading that for the sake of improving a reading habit, but now it's very important for the sake of improving your knowledge about current affairs. That's going to help you out a lot. I believe that's primarily with respect to CLAT.
All right, perfect.
One thing I missed out on was read the instructions. That was the downfall of many people who attempted CLAT this year. Because one of the instructions was that unless you unmark a question, like if you want to change your answer, unless you unmark the question, unmark your original answer and then mark the new answer, you won't be awarded a mark for it. Your answer won't change. It will still remain the default answer if you straight off take the other answer right. Like, unless you first unmark it, that step is very important. Many people did not read the instructions, they did not do that step, and they ended up losing out their opportunity in getting into a doctor in LU.
All right. So, you know, once you were done with all this, how was the college shortlisting process like? Because you also got into Shahid Sukhdev College of Business Studies and you were also getting these good, you know, NLUs. So, you know, how did you make the decision?
So, on the basis of my CLAT rank, I got into NALSA Hyderabad, which is number two when it comes to the CLAT area of law colleges. ALET is specifically for NLU Delhi and I managed to get into that as well. So, initially, I had faced a choice between these two. But my rank in CLAT was such that there was a slight probability that I might get into NLS Bangalore, which is the best law school in India. But arguably, one might argue that it is not. So that's an argument for a different discussion. But I had the option of these two colleges. The DUJAT result came way after the admission process. I believe I had already paid the fees, etc. and I had already had my induction by the time the results arrived. Between NLU Delhi and NALSA, primarily the reason I chose Delhi was because of its location. Being in Delhi, apart from the fact that it's near to my place, it also has the advantage of being in the national capital, so you get access to the High Court, Supreme Court, etc. And of course, a lot of corporate houses are more likely to be in Delhi than in Hyderabad. So that's one of the reasons I chose NLU Delhi over NALSA. If you are from the south, maybe NALSA might be your first preference, but really you'll have to research upon that a lot. Like that's a very long discussion. The results for DUJAT came a bit after these two. So by the time I had taken admission in NLU Delhi, and at that point I was so satisfied by, like, because after the entrance exams I was really very, very afraid. So I was so satisfied with my results at that point. I was like, all right, I'm cool. Like I don't want to say Sukhdev. I'm happy where I am. So that was my reasoning. But the thing was, I had already been so focused towards law at that point, which is one of the reasons I did not even give a second thought to DUJAT. Like, I got an email that my application status is updated and I realized that I had somehow cracked it. I don't know how I did not prepare for it this year. But I did not give a second thought because I was happy pursuing law at that point.
Okay, that's great. Now, you know, you talk about, you know, being satisfied with the college you already were in. And also, even if we factor in the condition that, you know, everything is online, how has your NLU experience been so far?
So, law is a very different field for our management. The college experience here has been radically different from my college experience in Rohtak. And I feel that the attitude of the administration is also quite different, because in these law schools, the student community is very active. So every decision making process does involve the opinion of the student community. So that's a very different environment from the corporate sort of corporate environment and the top down approach you'll find in IIMs. So it's been a very different environment for me. And I have never been to my college really. I've only attended online classes. So it's tough to say how it will be like physically, especially since most of the people who are watching this video will join the college physically. So their experience will be different from mine. But I can assure you that the administration here is very understanding. In terms of student approachability and administration friendliness, I'd say that NLUs are probably better than IIMs. When it comes to the experience, as I said, NLUs have a lot of alumni and senior batches. So they have a culture of student-senior interaction and a student, and they have a good senior-junior relationship. So one thing I found lacking in IIM Rohtak was that I did not have anyone to look up to. I did not have anyone to talk to about how to go about with my stuff. Here, at the very least, I have some seniors who have been very welcoming and they are ready to address any of your issues at any point. So that's a very different thing. When it comes to the academics, law schools are very theoretical when it compared to a B school. Because in B school, you are dealing with a lot of practical situations. You are dealing with a lot of practical subjects. Most top law schools only offer you a BA LLB, not a BB LLB. Some law schools like I believe GNLU, etc., they offer you a BB LLB, but generally it's a BA. So BA, NBA have very different subjects from an IPM program, and these are very, very theoretical in nature. So if you're somebody who enjoys practical subjects like maths, etc., you will probably not be satisfied in the law school. You'll find more happiness in a B school. So you need to look at your interest before you decide that, okay, this is the field you want to go into.
Okay, thank you for a very wonderful explanation. So, you know, now that you have had experience with both sides of the coin, do you think it is advisable to be aiming for both management entrances along with legal entrances?
See, as I said earlier, keep your options open, but it's still preferable to be focused on one. I mean that, if you have the resources to do so, go ahead and fill the entrance fee of both the exams. Prepare specifically towards one exam. The reason I was able to crack IPMAT in 2019 was because I was not diverting myself with CLAT, etc. too much. I only gave them for the sake of experience. The reason I could crack CLAT, etc., CLAT and ELIT with a decent rank this year was because I was not divesting myself too much into IPMAT preparation. I studied a little bit of maths, but I only gave it a few days. That's it. 1 week. I believe I studied almost just for 1 week, specifically with respect to IPMAT. The entire time I was studying for CLAT. So I'll stay, pick a focus depending upon your interest and go along with that.
Perfect. And if in case someone were to do preparation for both of those, what do you think, what material or, you know, resources they should refer to? Like maybe for QA, they should be referring to IPMAT material. For legal reasoning or, you know, logical reasoning, it would be for CLAT or something of that sort.
Well, definitely, because the QA segment of IPMAT is insanely tougher than CLAT. CLAT QA does not even come close to the kind of mathematics you'll be facing in IPMAT. So if you are someone who knows that they can balance the preparation of both the exams, then preferably study the quants portion of IPMAT. And when it comes to vocabulary, I'd say both of them are at a similar level. When it comes to verbal reasoning, sorry, not vocabulary. When it comes to vocabulary, CLAT has an upper edge. It demands a little more vocabulary than your IPMAT preparation. And when it comes to logical reasoning, I'd say both are at a similar level with respect to that. ELIT, however, has a different level. It has a very high level of logical reasoning. So preferably study, because the thing is, not many people study specifically for ELIT. Because getting into NLU Delhi is as much luck as much hard work, because there's a very few seats and 30,000-40,000 people competing for those maybe for 50 seats in the general category. So it's highly based upon luck. So preferably, if you know, like if you really want to target ELIT, NLU Delhi, etc., then go ahead, study the reasoning portion of ELIT, because that's the toughest among the all three. When it comes to DOJAT, it's quite easy, to be honest. It's easier than all these exams. So if you're studying for any of these exams, you'll easily crack the DOJAT. I'd never studied for DOJAT, and yet somehow I managed to get a good rank both years.
Okay, that's perfect. Now, my next question to you was supposed to be the differences between law and management, but you've already covered that in your LLU experience. So, you know, concluding this, do you have any final message for all the aspirants of 2021, given the times of uncertainty in you? How do you, or how should they go about preparing themselves for these upcoming entrances?
I understand that these are very tough times and there's going to be a lot of uncertainty in the future. You don't know that if the exam is going to happen in July or if it's going to happen all the way in October. But the thing is, you just have to hold on to hope. Especially if you're a dropout, you really, really need to get yourself together, because this is your one opportunity to shine. You've already had a lot of time. I won't use the term wasted, because it's not a waste. I never consider my IIM experience a waste. It always helps me out in NLU as well. But still, you spend a lot of time, and you're going, and unless you just give it one last shot, you're going to regret it. So just tie your seatbelts and get ready with the exams. Hopefully, you'll be able to crack whichever exam, MATLAT, etc. you're aiming for. But even if you don't regret it too much, because I've seen many people from lower, like not that famous colleges, still make it good. So many people believe that once you get into an IIM or once you get into top tier NLU, tomorrow life set. That's the phrase used. But that's not true. I've forgotten how many times people tell me that, why did you drop out of an IIM? Like, your life was set in IIM. But that's not true, because getting into them is one thing, and actually succeeding in making a career in that particular institute, that's entirely different thing. The only thing is, it gives you the resources that you need to achieve success. But that can be done even if you're studying in a not so great college. So don't despair even if you are not able to crack these exams. But definitely, that should not be your mentality right now. Right now, just focus on cracking the exams and go with the mentality that if you're attempting it, then you can do it.
Okay, that was a very wonderful and elaborated discussion, and I'm sure a lot of people will learn a lot of things from this. So with that being said, you know, I'll also leave on the same concluding lines that, you know, the times are uncertain, but use it to your potential. If the exams are getting delayed, then take it as an advantage. You have more time to prepare for all this. So just keep on preparing. Don't lose hope. Prepare till the time the exams are not held. And just believe in yourself, have faith in yourself, and you shall do well. And with that being said, you know, I'd like to thank you for being a part of, you know, this interview and, you know, accepting my request for this. It's surely been, you know, a wonderful interview, and I'm sure, you know, a lot of people will get helped by this. So that's about it. And if in case you like this video and if in case you found it helpful, you might as well want to like it and subscribe to the channel for more such interviews. So that's about it. Thanks for joining in, and I hope you do well in your entrances. Thank you. Stay safe and good luck.